Okay, welcome. Welcome to the Church of Perpetual Life. I'm so glad that you are here tonight. You're in the right place at the right time for the right reason. My name is Neil Vandry. I'm your officiator here, and I'd like to welcome everyone online for being here as well. I'd like to see a show of hands for the people who are here for the very first time. Your first time here? Let me see you. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Great. Glad to have you all. Yes, of course. So glad that you're here. You know, you'll want to join our email list so that we can keep you informed about all the things that are going on and give you all of the updates and let you know what's going on with the church and all of the updates in the longevity community, especially those of you who are here for the first time. Be sure to get on that list. And if you didn't hear from me, if you didn't get an email, how many people got an email that you saw the email about the event? How many people received a text? Maybe you got a text? How many people got a phone call from Shri? You got a call? Great. And we're going to be converting some of the phone calling into texting. So if you want to get a phone call, you'll get a message about that. So tonight we have two excellent presentations and also a couple of very fun transhumanist videos with Charlie Cam. So please join me now, though, in reciting our creed. We believe that all of life is sacred and that we have been given this one life to make unlimited. We believe in our Creator's divine plan for all of humanity to have infinite lifespans in perfect health and eternal joy, rendering death to be optional. By following our gospel, we achieve eternal life, creating a heaven here on earth. And we follow Nikolai Fedorov, who taught that the transcendence of the Creator will only be solved when humanity, in our unified efforts, become an instrument of universal resuscitation, when the divine word becomes our divine action. And we follow Arthur C. Clarke, who said, the only way to discover the limits of the possible is to go beyond them into the impossible. And so we enter each day, energized in spirit and empowered by the words of our prophets, to live in joy, serving our Creator and all of mankind forever and ever. Now, if you're curious about cryonics, you'll find many resources here in our library, in the social hall, on cryonics and other health and longevity topics. Feel free to talk with me or any of our members if you'd like more information about cryonics. We'd like to welcome your donations tonight. We have some boxes out in the social hall for your donations, and we are very grateful for those donations that help us to have better and improve our services. If you're online, you'll go to our website at perpetual.life, and you'll find the donation tab at the top of the website. As I mentioned, tonight we have two amazing presentations for you, so please make note of your questions. After the presentation, we'll have time for questions and answers, and we'll be taking questions and answers from the live stream and the Zoom, as well as here live in person. First, we'd like to start off with Charlie Cam tonight. Charlie was the candidate for president of the Transhumanist Party in the last presidential election. Charlie Cam is also a renowned songwriter and singer and entrepreneur, as well as a member of Humanity Plus, the Immortalist Institute, the World Future Society, the Singularity Institute, and the Alcor Life Extension Foundation. So let's bring Charlie Cam up. Charlie, come on up, and he's going to introduce his first fun video.
Thank you, Neil, for that introduction. I want to add one thing to that introduction. I'm a lucky person. I want to put lucky person on my resume because one of my good friends that I've worked with for almost the last 20 years, we work together, we're friends. He's my mentor, Ray Kurzweil. And, you know, having that kind of friend is amazing because if you do want to live for a long time, he's the kind of guy who has all this amazing knowledge. And if you don't know who he is, look up his books. He's written The Singularity is Near, a lot of great stuff. He was written up in Forbes magazine as the ultimate thinking machine. So he's this brilliant guy. And I've been lucky enough to have him, like I said, as a friend and somebody I work with. And you would think that'd be lucky enough to have one guy like that in my life. And now it turns out I've got another guy that I'm working with, and his name is Ashish Tripathi. And I work now with his company, too. It's Tzar Labs. And I would tell you about him, but you're going to learn all about him because he's coming up after they show my presentation. So for two reasons right there, I feel like lucky person should be added to my resume. But there's another reason that I'm lucky, and that's because I'm born now. You know, I'm born in this day and age, which, by the way, you're all lucky. If you were born now, well, you guys are lucky, because if you were born a few hundred years ago, let's say, look, Shakespeare wrote his most, he made his most famous statement about 400 years ago when, I think it was Act 3, Scene 1, Hamlet came out and said, to be or not to be, that is the question. Well, you know, he was referring to whether he should live or die. Now that, technically, that was a flawed question because, you know, sadly for him, he didn't really have a choice. He was going to die. Because back then, not only was Hamlet dying, but Shakespeare and anybody born back then was going to die. But we are the lucky ones that were born now. We're born in a time where there is technology that can be able to regenerate parts of our body, and we can do gene therapy, and there's organ transplants. One of my friends, Martine Rothblatt's got a company that, Revivicor, where they are developing organs inside of, that are transplantable from pigs to humans. They did that last year for a person that needed a new heart, and it worked. I mean, we're so close to being able to live long and in an indefinite lifespan that it's just incredible. And really, you guys are in the right place. And knowing people like Neil and Bill Faloon and Ashish, for that matter, those are the people you want to know, because you're part of that group that is going to be in the know about how to keep yourself going. And this first film that I put together, it's a lighthearted film, but I made it for something called the Longevity Film Competition. And basically we had to cover three or four things, and one of them was that aging is technically a disease. I know we don't call it a disease, but really it is a disease, because it's always the number one risk factor for any disease, but in itself it is a disease, so we got to start thinking about it that way. The other thing is that people say, well, aging is natural, so if it's natural, it must be good. Well, that's really not true at all. Especially if you live in Florida, you know a hurricane is natural, and that's not good at all. So, and the other thing is that they say, well, anti-aging things that are coming out, that's for the rich people. That's for rich people. That's not going to come. Well, look, you know what? The first iteration of any new technology is always the worst, and then it gets better, and then the price point comes down. This was true for cell phones. And, you know, the fourth thing that we had to cover in this particular film festival entrance was that aging, you know, if we do extend age, does that mean you're going to be alive a lot longer, but, you'd be 150 and barely moving around. Well, that's not fun. So the goal of any life extension is really not just about living your lifespan longer, but your health span. So you want to live healthily. And that's what's coming. You know, there's a lot of stuff going on. You mentioned that I ran for president with the United States Transhumanist Party, which that was fun. I knew I wasn't going to win, although there's a local candidate that says the election was stolen. So maybe I am president. But my vice presidential nominee was Liz Parrish. And if you guys know, if you don't know who Liz Parrish, Google. She's the CEO of BioViva. And she came up with this brilliant way of extending telomeres. Now, the FDA wasn't about to allow her to just go do it, so she flew out of the country with a team, and she injected herself. She said, if I believe in this, it's got to work for me. Well, it worked. Her telomeres are actually 20% extended. Well, now, if you don't know what telomeres are, just look them up. But you'll know. You probably know. In any case, it's supposedly going to make you live a lot longer. So, as I was saying about this this film competition, those are the parameters that had to be part of what it was. So I entered it. I actually won an award for this film. It was maybe about 25 entrants, so it wasn't like a lot, but still. And the thing about so when you see it, and you might have seen it before. I think we showed it at the previous location of this church, and so I was a little concerned. I don't want to bore everybody with these silly things, but. So I changed the music around. Doug, were we able to? Oh, we did. Okay. So I threw a little Frank Sinatra in there for you. Yeah, make it a little fun. So we could show the film now. I'll get out of the way here and. Okay.
Fairy tales can come true. It can happen to you if you're young it's hard, you will find, to be narrow of mind, if you're young at heart. You can go to extremes with impossible schemes. You can laugh when your dreams fall apart at the seams. And life gets more exciting with each passing day. And love is either in your heart or on its way.
I guess we're on the same floor, huh?
I guess so.
After you.
Hey, I see that we're neighbors, huh? I don't remember seeing you before, but it looks like you're a doctor?
Yeah, I'm Dr. Adlix, working on anti-aging. We're about to start human clinical trials.
Oh, well, that sounds really interesting. Hey, maybe we should get together for a drink sometime. I'd like to learn more about it.
Oh, thanks anyway, but I am really busy. Maybe next time.
Dad, where you at?
Science.
We got no time for that. Come on. I gotta save you. I'm gonna save you. You're gonna be safe.
What's going on? What are we doing here?
Don't worry.
Oh, what's going on?
Well, I wanted to bring my dad back because he wanted to find out more about your anti-aging thing, if that's okay. Because can we come in? Can we come in?
Oh, okay. Come on in. Have a seat on the couch.
First, the most important thing you have to understand is that aging is a disease.
Aging is a disease? What are you talking about? That aging is not a disease? What do you mean? What are you talking about?
Actually, aging is the worst disease. Did you know 100,000 people die every day because of age-related diseases? Which means one person dies every second.
Every second?
As we get older, our tissues wear down and we eventually become susceptible to the many diseases that we can no longer fight off. So if we can stop aging, we can essentially fight off those diseases.
Aging is natural. You're not supposed to interfere with nature. Time for my pill. High blood pressure pill.
But wait, see? Right there, what you just did. You took a pill to help you with your blood pressure. You basically just interfered with aging. And there's nothing wrong with that. Because whether you believe we got our brain from God or evolution, they're there for us to use them to better our world and ourselves. And with the way science is progressing with rejuvenation therapies, it looks like we will all soon be living at least 150 years, possibly more.
He's 90 years old. He could barely walk. If he didn't have a diaper on right now, things would be pretty messy in here. No way he wants another 60 years of his misery.
Wait, that's not what she means, is it?
The kind of life extension I am talking about wouldn't just keep us alive longer. It would actually improve our health immensely so that we'd have younger bodies again and therefore be living in a great shape indefinitely.
Well, this all sounds great, but it also sounds like it's going to cost a lot of money, and we haven't got that kind of cash to spare. It is going to cost a lot, right?
You're right. It will cost a lot.
Ha! See, I told you.
At first. But just like the development of any technologies, it starts out expensive, then very quickly the price point drops while the quality improves. Just like what happened with cell phones. And these new treatments are coming to us faster and faster. Some are already here, and it's important that you take advantage of them. So, would you like to sign up?
So does that mean I have to bring my dad to see you every day for treatments?
No, he will be at my clinic for 6 months. So, would you like to live long and prosper?
Go, how did the Holy cow! You look great!
And I feel great. That treatment really worked. I feel like a kid again!
This is great news. Now I can go out and celebrate with Dr. Radlix. Dr. Radlix, I was just coming to see you. Wow, you look great too. Anyway, I wanted to thank you for what you did for my dad, and I guess you're here so we can go out for those drinks too, right?
Oh, sorry, but I already have a date tonight.
You already have a date? With who?
Excuse me?
Dad?
See you later.
Bye.
Oh, Dr. Radlix, wait, 1 second. I had one more question for you before you go. Well, I wanted to know, he looks younger and everything, but he's still 90 years old, and, you know, there's a big age difference. What do you have in common?
I guess you didn't read my book, the one your dad was reading. Maybe you should. Have a good night.
And if you should survive to 105, look at all you'll derive out of being alive. And here is the best part, you have a head start if you are among the very young.
Okay, Charlie, what a great video. And Agla, will you stand for a moment? The star, Dr. Radlix, is here with us as well. Great film. How many people saw it for the first time tonight? There you go. Okay. Our featured guest speaker tonight is the founder and CEO of Tzar Labs and the director of Epigeners Biotech, Ashish Tripathi. The company has made a series of major breakthroughs in molecular diagnostics, and he is spearheading this global launch. He has 20-plus years doing investment banking, corporate finance, mergers and acquisitions, strategy, business services, and financial planning experience. He has worked for a variety of multinational corporations, including Edelweiss, Ernst & Young, Avendis, Fairfax, Mincom, NTT Communications, Deutsche Bank, and Deloitte Touche Tamatsu across USA, Europe, Asia, and Australia. Now, please listen very carefully as you'll hear some really amazing news tonight. Please keep track of your questions, as we will have a questions and answer series after the talk. Please welcome to the stage now Ashish Tripathi to Perpetual Life. Ashish.
My name is Ashish Tripathi. It's a really pleasure. It's a pleasure to be speaking to this audience. I actually spoke at RadFest last year, and I promised Neil and Charlie that I would, the next time I'm in the US, I will definitely come and speak to you guys. So so this is why I'm here, and I'm fulfilling my promise. There are a couple of very interesting things that you guys are gonna hear today. What I am going to do is I'm going to spend a lot of time on the science, right? And the way I like to put it is that, if I can understand it, I can explain it to anyone. So, but if you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer it because it is very cutting-edge science. So to begin with, let me start by making a couple of very bold claims. And like I said, as I walk you through the presentation, I'll explain the science and explain why this works. So there are a couple of global firsts that we claim. One, this is the first pan-cancer blood test, right? So it can detect every cancer from a blood test, but more interestingly, we can detect it earlier than any known technology. It's known as cancer in situ. Scientists understand what the concept is. It means that cancer cells have embedded a organ and are proliferating, but the physical tumor has not formed as yet. We can actually detect cancer quite accurately even at that stage. What was not published in the Springer Journal article that came out last year when we published the science was that we can also tell you which cancer and where it is growing straight from a blood test. So that's claim one. Claim two, this is the first prognostic test for cancer. From a blood test, we can tell you that you do not have cancer. But more interestingly, we can tell you that you will not get cancer for the next 1 year, because what we are essentially measuring are the biomarkers for the different cancers, right? So if you are within a safe zone, we know that the fastest cancer can't move from here to a tumor stage in 1 year. You can see a use case of a test like that. It means it's a blood test that all of us need to do once a year, and we will either catch cancer at stage one or before, when it is infinitely more curable, right? That's claim two. Claim three, and this is a big one. Not only can I tell you what your cancer is, what the primary organ is, so I can tell you that this is liver cancer. I can tell you it's liver cholangiocarcinoma from a blood test. I can tell you the secondary affected organs. There are secondary tumors in the lungs and bones. I can tell you something unique. The next target organ is going to be the pancreas, so it's stage zero of the next organ. I can tell you mutations, dysfunctional pathways that you get from a biopsy of the tumor tissue, straight from a blood sample, not just for the primary tumor, but also for secondary tumors, right? Why is this important? The latest research from Salk Institute and so many institutes in the US shows that as soon as you do a biopsy, you spread the tumor, right? Because it leads to leakages of the tumor cells. So not only can we actually stop that, because we can actually do it from a blood sample, but more importantly, when you do a biopsy, you only get the transcriptomic readings of that primary tumor. You don't get it for the secondary tumors. Sometimes, or more often than not, the driver mutations at the later stages are coming from a secondary tumor, not from the primary tumor. We can give you the readings for all of them from a blood sample, right? Now, we're not magicians, right? The first question that you need to be asking yourself is, are we Theranos, right? And more importantly, what you want to be asking is, why would a company in India or Singapore be making this breakthrough, and why not in India? Why not in the US, right? For very legitimate reasons, US is considered the healthcare capital of the world, especially from a research perspective. The answer is actually quite simple. We got lucky, right? We were essentially a drug company. We were working on a cancer drug. And when we were studying the pathways of the cancer drug, we made a very significant breakthrough. We realized that it was acting on certain mutations in stem cells. What we realized was that there's a mutation happening on a stem cell that leads to cancer cells. Cancer stem cells. The cancer stem cells create the cancer cells. The cancer cells then have a billion of them come together to form a 1 cubic centimeter tumor. Once the tumor has formed, it starts to actually shed its outer layers, which is called CTCs. Once the CTCs break down, they release ctDNA. The entire liquid biopsy company was busy looking for CTCs and ctDNA. What we realized was that we had found a causative marker, right? So what is the problem with that method? When my body has 5.5 liters of blood. So when I take out 5 ml of blood, I'm taking out 0.1% of the total volume of blood in my body. If I see a tumor cell, right, I know I have cancer. But if I don't see a tumor cell, does not mean I don't have cancer. It means in the very small sample of blood that you took out, there was no tumor cell. Hence, what ends up happening is that you get a lot of false negatives, right? Cancer patients being told they don't have cancer, right? Worse, at the early stages, right, when you want to detect the cancer the most, right, which is at stage one and stage two, you get the worst results because there are very few CTCs floating about in the blood. I take it you guys know about the progression of the cancer. The first stage is a localized disease. So if I have lung cancer, it's growing in my lung tissue. Right? Stage two is it's creating vascularity and it's creating blood vessels, blood connections, and therefore it's leaking into the blood. Right? Stage three is when it connects to the lymph nodes. Stage four, broadly, is when it is a metastasized disease. Right? So this is basically what is happening as far as cancer is concerned. At the early stages, you have very few of these CTCs in the blood. Right? Now, same example, right? If I take out 5 ml of my blood, do I see my red blood cells there? The answer is obvious. The color of the blood is still red, so of course your red blood cells are there. Do you see your white blood cells there? Answer is yes. Do you see your stem cells there? Answer is yes. And as soon as we see the stem cells, we realize that all we need to do is look at those specific markers, and we are able to tell you before the cancer is formed, right, that you are about to get cancer. So essentially, when we take the blood sample, when we take a blood sample, we effectively isolate our specific stem cells, and we are essentially looking for specific markers on those cells, right? Now, I'll give you a broad understanding of how HRC works, right? But on the left side, the green sample results are for non-cancer patients. The red sample results are for cancer patients, right? The way it works is that if you get a zero, so if I was to take my blood or your blood, right, we would typically land up getting a 0 to 2 reading. What it means is that we don't have cancer. But more interestingly, we will not get cancer for the next 1 year, because even the fastest cancers don't move from 2 to 10 on these markers, right, within 1 year. So look at the beauty of this test. It's actually telling you a prognostic reading that you will not get cancer in the next 1 year. Now, there are certain inflammatory markers that move this in the 2 to 6 territory, right? It's still that you don't have cancer, right? But what is happening is that there is some pressure forming in certain specific organs. The interesting data set that we found is that 6 is the marker that not any other disease is crossing except for cancer, right? So once you cross 6, we get very worried, and we will do a follow-on test. I'll tell you about that, right? But effectively, that is the stage where you literally land up seeing imminent cancer patients, right? Because that means that cancer cells are embedding, right? And we can actually isolate that particular organ, do mutation readings, and then confirm that data. 10 to 20 is stage 1, and so on and so forth. So look at the beauty of this. It is actually telling you all the stages of cancer, but also telling you all the stages of non-cancer. Please note that when you're actually looking at liquid biopsy companies, right, you are looking for tumor cells. The absence of tumor cells indicate non-cancer, right? Absence of evidence is not the same as evidence of absence, right? And that is essentially why we land up getting very, very accurate readings. Now, we have done 8,000 patient study, which is what got published in the Springer Journal 2 years back. It actually got a significant amount of press coverage in India, but since we've actually spoken to a lot of scientists in NHS and Harvard now, their entire thought process was that, listen, you know, we had seen the article. It's just that, like everyone, we thought you guys were also looking at a tumor cell-based approach, right? But because you had done it in India, you were claiming 100% sensitivity. And we said, look at the paper. It specifically states, right, that we weren't looking at cancer cells. Right now, we have cancer studies going on with the NHS, right? It is under trial, but the point is that once that data comes out, it will be published pretty soon, and you will see the results for yourselves. Because we had already completed the study in India, we have actually gone through the process to get all the regulatory permissions to launch the product in India. In fact, it just got launched earlier this year in India. But what we expect is that the next market where it's going to get launched is in UK. And we are actually talking to a number of companies in Europe and also in the US and trying to see how quickly we can get it to the US as well. But let me get back to what was the study. We did a 1,000 patient study, simple design where they took 500 cancer patients, different cancers, right? And 500 non-cancer patients. Let me explain, these were declared non-cancer patients, right? And they did do a CTC result because they needed empirical evidence, but the essential idea was that how much accuracy can we get from a blinded sample, because all we got was a blood sample with a code on it. From that, we were able to detect each and every non-cancer patient, right? You understand what that means? The readings were 0 to 2, some of them were 2 to 6. Right? That was the kind of accuracy we had. We detected each and every fourth stage cancer patient, each and every third stage cancer patient, each and every second stage cancer patient, each and every first stage cancer patient, and we detected a couple of people who were imminent cancer and they didn't know it. We were able to show it to the CRO, right? So we were in this unique position where we did not get even one false negative, not one false positive, right? Again, bear with me. I'm going to get into the science slides, but I'll explain to you how and why this happens. The CRO that conducted the study wanted to see that are we somehow detecting medication, right? So they had cut the cancer patients by cancer treatment patients, Rx-naive patients, that is cancer patients where the treatment has not started, cancer detected, but treatment has not started, and R0 patients. So for example, if someone has breast cancer, but they've done a lumpectomy, well, the tumor has been removed, right? It didn't really matter because we landed up getting such high accuracy. This is perhaps the most interesting slide. Remember that when I say that this works on every cancer, right? Cancer is a very complex disease. There are 200 different types of cancer, 3,000 subtypes of cancer, right? So in a 1,000-patient study, you're never going to cover every cancer, right? But the point is that there were 25 different cancers. All the big ones were there: breast, ovarian, lung, leukemia, prostate, pancreatic, colon, right? What fascinated the doctors is it's working on solid cancers, it is working on blood cancers, it is working on soft tissue sarcomas, right? Again, the question in your mind will be how. So let me now go into the science slides, right? And as I said, I'll try and explain it, but I'll be happy to answer any questions, right? There are in fact two tests, okay? There's an HRC test, and there's a all organ biopsy, omni organ biopsy test. The HRC test is all about putting you in four buckets, right? It's about cancer absent, right? In which case we tell you go away, come back next year and do the test again, right? Indeterminate. Please note that we have launched the service in India. We were specifically advised by oncologists, please do not use the word cancer risk, right? You're not trying to cause any mental anguish to someone, because we know at this stage there can be people that don't have cancer, this can be other diseases as well, right? So effectively, we just call it indeterminate, but the point is that we tell you to come back within 6 months because our intent is to catch it early every time, right? Imminent is actually what we consider to be the most effective stage to catch this disease, right? Because what people don't realize is that cancer is actually a weak disease so long as you catch it early, right? You catch it late, and it grows at a furious pace, right? A mature tumor is sending out nearly 1 million CTCs a day, right? So at that point in time, you are dealing with a very, very progressive, fast-progressing disease, right? And cancer present, right? We can actually do staging and tumor burden information as well. But as I said, we have actually developed this in consultation with doctors in India. And they said that stay away from staging, because the fact is that a 2 cubic centimeter tumor, but on the cusp of two organs, is considered fourth stage. 10 cubic centimeter tumor, but in one organ, in a lung or a liver, right, is considered stage two, right? So they said, stay away from this. You are doing a great service for someone. Think about, how do you actually dictate that cancer has gone into remission, right? I can go into the details of it, but believe me, there are a lot of question marks, right, how we define remission, right? The other thing is that think about cancer relapse, right? The reason this research is important to me is I lost someone very important to me, my brother-in-law. And I think if you actually Google me, you'll know about his story. I come from a pretty famous family in India, and I lost my brother-in-law whose cancer came back after 16 years, right? He was an extremely diligent guy, continued his, he had renal cancer. Right. After 4 years, he was told by doctors that you are now safe. You have the same risk as anyone that does not have cancer. Right. But he still continued the tests for another 10 years. Right. Who would expect that it comes back after 16 years? Right. And interestingly, they still claim that cancer is actually because of cancer cells. Well, which cell lasts 16 years? I'd love to know. Right. But be that as it may, the point is that this is basically what HRC is about. It's just about a pure screening test, right? What risk are you at? Because the agenda here is our vision is about trying to make cancer into an early stage disease. You make it into an early stage disease, right? You will save a lot of lives. The bigger product, right, which is the whole organ biopsy, is actually the more interesting product because we can tell you cancer type and subtype. We can tell you primary organ. We can tell you it's liver cancer. We can tell you secondary organs. It's spread into lung. It's spread into bone. We can tell you next target organ, like I said, understand what that means. It means a new organ has been metastatically impacted, right? Cancer cells are embedded and are proliferating, but the physical tumor has not formed. So if you did a CT scan or a PET scan, it would not be visible, right? We can detect it at that stage. We can, sorry. Yeah, yeah. So we can tell you the mutations, we can tell you the altered expressions, we can tell you the dysregulated pathways, right? So there are a lot of things that we can do. Again, the question will be how, right? Let me explain the basic science. My body has 70 trillion cells, right? There are 50 billion cells that die every day and are replaced. There are 200 different classes of cells. Now, please understand that this is, you know, it depends on how you define it. There will be papers that will define it separate, differently, but your, essentially, your brain cells are very different to your blood cells, right? Or your lung cells, and so on and so forth. So it's about defining the different types of cells in the body. Now, interestingly, the original breakthrough was not made by us, right? It was made by an individual who actually, you know, an American scientist in an American university, who actually isolated these cells that are pluripotent stem cells. Pluripotent stem cells, by definition, are cells that can grow into any of the 200 cells in your body. So all it can grow into any organ, right? So essentially, there's a lot of primary data which has been done on tissues from different organs, right? And they have been able to see the cell in all organs. Right? Now, the point is, why is this important? I'm first going to tell you what happens in a healthy body, and then I'll explain to you how this connects with cancer. These pluripotent stem cells, right, usually stay quiescent, right? So let's say I do something simple like scratching my hand. Well, I've just killed 1,000 cells, right? These cells, like the 50 billion cells in my body, need to be replaced. What's the mechanism? These pluripotent stem cells just stay quiescent, right, until you create demand, right? Once demand is created, these cells will then do asymmetric cell division. You can literally see them under a microscope, where they will form a cap and a big bottom, and they will separate into two cells. What are they doing? They're also called immortal cells because they're replicating their numbers. But they create a progenitor. Now, that progenitor is different in different organs. So in the blood, it could be hematopoietic stem cell. In the brain, it could be neuronal stem cell. In the ovaries, it will be an ovarian stem cell, right? So understand that the progenitor is different, but this cell is staying common in different organs. Now the progenitor then goes through a symmetric cell division where it'll break up, or it'll go through clonal formation, or go through clonal expansion where the cells are being replicated. What is it doing? You see one ash, then you'll see two ashes, then you'll see 10 ashes. Why? Well, there's a big order, right? There's 50 billion cells to be made. So we are replicating those cells. Once those cells have been copied, it actually creates what is called a tissue-committed progenitor. This tissue-committed progenitor then starts off what's called terminal differentiation. So just like a baby goes into a toddler, then goes into a teenager, then goes into an adult, right? A grows to B, B grows to C, C grows to D, right? And that D is actually your terminal cell. It's your dermal cell that has been replaced in the example I just gave you. Now, this will have a set life. It'll live for, let's say, 200 days, at which point it will die, right? And it'll get replaced. Alternatively, I'll do this and kill it again, and then it'll be replaced. This is effectively the process that happens day in and day out in all our bodies. Now, what happens in cancer, we realized, was something different. Because of exposure to carcinogens, because of endocrine insults, because of genetic predispositions, it really doesn't matter, right? What we realized was there were certain measurable epigenetic and mutation readings that we can get from these cells. But what it essentially does is creates what is a cancer stem cell. This cancer stem cell, so think about it like Jekyll and Hyde. The earlier stem cell was Jekyll. This one is Hyde. It doesn't stay quiescent, right? It just starts actually multiplying, right? So it, you know, and each multiplication creates the chain that I'm going to explain. When it starts to multiply, that CSC, when it goes through the asymmetric cell division, it creates a progenitor, right? But that progenitor is cancerous. That progenitor will then go through somatic cell division, go to clonal formation, and when it comes to clonal expansion, when you see it under a microscope, it literally forms like a pancake-like structure, which is actually creating a huge number of mutations, right? Now think about it. If I was to actually write something on a whiteboard out here, right, and we ask someone to come and clean it up, and he does a great job, then you tell him, hey, you're doing such a great job. You know what? I can think of about 50 conference halls out here. I want each of those boards kept as clean as you're doing this, right? He's going to start making mistakes because there's just too much work, right? Now, effectively, that is what is happening. You have a lot of mutated. Look, your genes are basically ATCG codes, right? When you start replicating it so fast, you start getting mutations. Now, this is the fundamental difference between how oncologists see the disease today versus how we see the disease, because they reckon that the mutation leads to cancer. And in one sense, they are right, because it's a precursor step. It's just not the original step, right? The original step happens when the cancer stem cells start to form. Now, once the mutation happens, let me close out the loop, it creates a tissue-committed progenitor, right? Now, if you remember, A was supposed to go to B, B was supposed to go to C, C was supposed to go to D. Well, B never forms, okay? Because that terminal cell is not now going to form. A does, in fact, grow to B, right? But at B, you have block differentiation. So think of a sewer pipe, right, which is flowing down, and then you just block it. The cells that come pouring out, these are cancer cells. If it happens at B, right, they are called poorly differentiated cancers. If it happens at C, it is called well-differentiated cancers. This is Siddharth Mukherjee's work, right? Now, what is the difference? Which is more dangerous? The poorly differentiated. Why? Because it's more primitive, it can differentiate more. Right? These are considered the more dangerous cancers. But essentially, what is happening in cancer is that you are seeing the formation of CSCs, you're seeing mutations, and you're seeing block differentiation. Now, why is that important? Those cancer cells feed into the tumor. A tumor is nothing but a billion cells of cancer coming together. It's a 1 cubic centimeter tumor, has a billion cells. Once the tumor forms, it starts to shed CTCs, right? Those CTCs actually are dying cells. They last only for about 4 hours. Half-life is only 4 hours, right? When they die, they basically start leaking their, the ctDNA and the cell-free RNA into the blood. Now, why is this important? This is called the Gumpertzian model. It was actually created by an English scientist, right, called Benjamin Gumpertz, right, who said that if you actually break, if you plot the number of cancer cells on the y-axis and time on the x-axis, right, cancer is going through three distinct phases: early phase, rapid expansion phase, and the plateau phase. And he said the tragedy of the disease is that we only understand the disease from a billion cells to a trillion cells. What does he mean? A billion cells is a 1 cubic centimeter tumor in any cancer. That's an early detection, right? A trillion cells, well, you've passed fourth stage and you've got fatality, right? But a billion cells don't form in a day, right? The reason we are an early detection company is because we can see it at 100 million cells. We can see it at 1 million cells. We can see it at 10,000 cells. We can see it at one cell. We can see it 6 months before the first cell is born because we are not interested in the cancer cell. We are looking at the cancer stem cell. Now, why is that important? This particular process of the CSC formation, right, starts a good 18 months before the tumor is even formed, right? So the reason this actually becomes such an accurate test, right, is because we have a major time advantage, right? The CSC population starts to increase 18 months before the tumor forms, right? So by the time the tumor forms, well, it's literally an avalanche of signals that we are getting, right? And once you know how to actually separate out the cells from the, because our science has gone way ahead of that now, not only can we actually cite these cells, but we can differentiate the ones that are primary, secondary, and tertiary. Once we separate it and we actually do sequencing, it is akin to actually doing the biopsy of the tumor itself, because these are the cells that are growing into that tumor. Right? So all we need to do is actually break down the cells and actually do a biopsy of, do a sequencing of that. It's as good as taking the tumor tissue and actually doing the sequencing. And that's the reason why we are able to tell you what is the primary, what is the secondary, what's the tertiary, et cetera. Sorry, I'll stop here. If you don't mind, I'll just make one other comment. I usually never speak about competition, right? For a simple reason that I personally think that cancer is such a complex disease, right? That if you're saving one life, I think you're doing you're doing a service, right? And of all the liquid biopsy companies that I know, I do respect this one company, Grail, which is actually doing its studies with NHS, right? But you know, they had published a famous paper in 2019, and I actually visited ASCO when they published it. And they basically shown that for 12 cancers, they were getting 18% success at stage one and 90% success at stage four, right? And the entire oncology community started making fun of them, saying that, listen, we don't need a confirmation of cancer at stage four, we need it at stage one. At stage one, your data is inadequate, right? It has since actually published that it was doing a Galleria study, and they have made public their papers, right? The data still shows sitting at 16.8% at stage one and 90% at stage four, right? Why is that? Because unfortunately, you are looking at, you know, even when you're looking at ctDNA, you're actually looking at a couple of strands of tumor DNA which you can find in the blood. Right? But what was interesting, or at least what our scientists found interesting, is that they had taken 80 to 90 ml of blood. You don't do a blood donation every time you want to do a blood test, right? And the point is, why are they taking so much blood? Because what they're hoping is that they can get at least a few strands of that tumor DNA. So you, since they couldn't find the needle in the haystack, well, the easy solution is let's increase the haystack, right? And my point is, well, why stop here? Take the whole 5.5 liters. Maybe you'll get more accuracy, right? The point is, you know, as my, you know, my father used to say, there's this old, you know, Indian story about this guy who was actually looking for a coin, right, under a lamppost. And then, you know, there were a couple of good Samaritans who saw this guy, you know, plugging away and said, hey, listen, you know, we should help him. And 5-6 of them started helping him. An hour later, one of them just asked, listen, are you sure you dropped the coin here? And he says, no, I dropped the coin 100 meters away. So why the hell are we looking out, you know, under this lamp? Oh, the light's here, right? So the point is, because people understand CTCs, they kept plugging away at looking at CTCs, right? Not understanding that you can never get that accuracy, because the reality is, firstly, you can never have an all-cancer test with CTCs, because there are many cancers that don't even produce CTCs, right? Two, even if they did produce CTCs, right? At an early stage, it's a localized disease. What are the chances that you're going to see fragments of that in the blood, right? And that's been our principle. But as I said, to begin with, we're not the smartest guys under the sun. We just got lucky. We were literally looking for, we were working on a drug, right? And there are many discoveries like this. I don't know if you guys know, post-it note. Right, was supposed to be a super glue, not a glue that doesn't stick. We'll tell that to the guys who made billions out of it, right? So the point is that we actually understood the significance of what we had found because we were cancer experts, right? And we realized that this is actually more important than even the drug, because if you can make cancer into an early stage disease, that changes the game. So yeah, that's what we're about.
Tremendous, great. Thank you, Ash. We have a number of questions I'm going to go through here. First question here, Randy.
Did your 1,000-person study include just people from India, or did it include other representative populations?
No, so we had done it only in India, right? That said, since then, we've had blood samples come from many parts of the world. There is one problem that we should actually tell you about, that we have one challenge, and I believe I was just talking to one of the members out here. We need fresh blood, right? So it's not like you can give us, you know, blood bank blood or something like that. We need blood drawn within the last 48 hours. So there's a couple of people that we are talking to, because we understand the nature of the cells that we're trying to isolate. But as long as we can keep the blood stable for longer, we should be able to help a lot of people even before the labs are created in the US or UK, et cetera. But this is the challenge that we do have.
So I understand that you can separate out the type or the stage of the cancer cells and even the organ.
Yeah.
Can you then take some of that organ or the cancer cells and produce an antibody to the cancer and therefore try to destroy it?
No. So I will. So let me tell you that, firstly, the reason we think our work is important, right, is because what we our claims are very simple, right? We want to make it into an early stage disease. To begin with, let me actually make clear that India allows us to claim imminent cancer, right? Since we are actually in trials with NHS, they've specifically told us that do not claim imminent cancer in UK, and I'm sure that's going to be the same logic in the US, right? So it's not about what your technology can do, it's about what your regulation will allow, right? Because in the US, the logic is, well, it will cause mental anguish to people if they know that they have cancer, right? But they can't see it through another study. Now, the counter argument to that is that, don't you cause mental anguish when you tell them you've got stage 2 cancer, right? I'd rather have someone telling me that I have stage 0 cancer than stage 2 cancer. But that's what they want is, they want us to follow, yeah.
I've been for a long time, and God knows. But what I'm concerned about is now that you have this, the question I ask is logical. Then if once you can isolate the tissue, you know where it is, you know what stage it is, then that would lead to therapies, right?
Yeah. So let me something that you would not have actually immediately recognized as an opportunity. Remember that the screening test, HRC, is about screening. But if I can tell you mutation readings, right? Imagine what it means to an oncologist. Today, so let me tell you, if you are actually dealing with a cancer patient, right, at a late stage. I don't mean to offend anyone if they are, oncologists and doctors, right, because I genuinely believe they have a very, very hard disease that they are fighting, right? But today, you may think that if you understand what the protocol system is, right, you may think that you're actually being treated by a doctor. What you're in fact being treated by is a lawyer, right? Because what lands up happening, what is the protocol system? The protocol system says that let's, God forbid, right, five of us, right, have lung cancer, right? What they will tell you is that go after, medicine number one, right, is actually has been shown to have an effective result, let's say in 35% of the patients, right? So they will recommend that, and believe me, that 35, that particular medicine will actually be the most expensive one, right? Because it's working on so many, right? But the point is, they will then give that to you, right? You will, of course, try that medicine. Now, let's say two of them get cured, lucky them, right? The other three, well, medicine one may not work, medicine five does, right? This is a fast deteriorating disease. By the time they get to medicine number five, they're going to be dead, right? So who are you helping, right? And the point is that the protocol system is basically what is followed, right? And why are you doing that? Well, because you're protected, right? As a doctor. So the future of medicine is going to be on, yeah? No, but the future of medicine is going to be on tailored medicines. Now imagine the value of this, that if I can tell you that this is the mutation on this patient, this is the mutation on this one, remember that actually once you start hitting the patient with a medication, right, the mutation, it mutates again, right? And the point is that we can actually tell you what the new mutation is, firstly, within 15 to 20 days. So you're not going to have to wait for 3 months for the next PET scan to actually see whether the cancer is actually staying stable, which is effectively what doctors do.
Doesn't this open up opportunities for alternative therapy?
There are going to be a lot of biotech companies that are going to start making, because unfortunately most of the medicines today that you see are actually sledgehammers, right? Because you're really dealing with third stage or fourth stage disease. Yeah. You hammer the tumor, but you're also hammering the person, right?
How much does it cost? And do you have an anticipated price versus time? Like, what will it cost? Yeah. 3 years from now,
firstly, from the starting position itself, right? Sorry. Yeah, please.
Also, is it available through Fountain Life or any of the diagnostic facilities in the United States?
So, look, the reason I'm here is because I'm answering your second question first, because we are speaking to some large companies and also certain startups. Look, the issue is more about actually you need to be right as far as the regulations are concerned, right? So understand that, you know, and it's legit. I mean, that's what most countries need to do. They need to actually do a clinical study in their country, right, before they allow their population to do it, right? Since we've already done the study in India, we've had a lot of regulatory support from India. And you can understand that from the Indian regulatory perspective, they're going, hey, you know, we made this breakthrough. So, you know, there's a lot more, you know, a lot of scientists that are sitting and listening to it, right? We have actually started NHS trials, and we are speaking to some very senior NHS doctors, and their position is that, listen, you prove it in NHS, the whole Western world is going to wake up to this, right? And admittedly, what they say is that if this is true, this changes how we're going to actually look at this disease, right? Because please understand that cancer is the second largest killer today, right? But it's the largest killer in the Western world. And I don't think that statistic does you know, justice to what this disease is. My wife is Australian, and I know a lot of affluent people, unfortunately, that get this disease, right? And they, you know, the family sells everything to save that one person, and they don't even save that person, and they're bankrupt, right? At some point, you need to question, I mean, humanity needs to question themselves, like, what are they doing? Right? So, answer to your question, we are not going to price it that high, right? We are going to keep driving this price down, because our position is that, listen, but in all fairness, right now, we know, because it's going to be launched in the UK, it's going to be at £400, right? It is a little cheaper than that, right? £400, right? $500, exactly. And our point is, you know what, our basic principle is that our investors will make money out of this, right? But the point is that if 8 billion people are doing this every year, well, you're going to make decent money, right? Because we're going to make small margins, but you're going to make decent money. But the point is that we personally believe that if everyone is doing this test, we will catch cancer every time at stage one, right? You do that. Sorry for that long answer, but I just wanted to give you a little background.
We have another question back here, but I think £400 is about $500.
Yeah.
Okay, Gaston?
Thank you. Fascinating, the whole topic and your presentation. Thank you for it. I'm extremely curious, and since we're in church, we can probably think of sacred space where there are no lawyers and no regulators. Because I'm very, very curious to hear what you have to say, and understanding that you're a diagnostic company, right?
Yeah.
But in your experience, anecdotal, what is happening to all those people with stage one, very early disease, that have no evidence of tumor? What are your doctors doing with that? I mean, what are the patients doing? What kind of worms is being opened with that, or what benefit is being brought?
Yeah.
Very curious about that.
I'm assuming you're talking about stage zero rather than stage one, because at stage one, it's detectable. And frankly, if you look at the statistics, I can just tell you for one cancer, because it was published in the UK recently, if you look at lung cancer, right, if you catch the disease at stage one, early, they said early, what they mean is stage one, right? The average life expectancy at 5 years is 95%, right? And the cost to the patient, right, is at £5,000 to £10,000. This was a publication about 1.5 years back. And they said the same patient, if you catch it late, and I assume they're talking fourth stage, right? Average life expectancy at 5 years was 5%. So exact opposite. And the cost to the patient was £150,000 to £200,000, right? So it just kind of lets you know what is the pain that this particular disease is causing. If you catch it at stage zero, right, in India, right, the reality is that technically, okay, regulatory wise, it's not a disease, right, at that stage, right? But we are already talking to biotech companies because we understand the nature. Look, the reason we've made this breakthrough is we have actually realized, or we believe we've realized, how cancer originates, right? Now, let me just rephrase that to you. President Nixon, right? I think it was, what, the 60s? Yeah? Yeah. He had made, 71, sorry. He had said that in the next decade, right, we're going to destroy cancer, right? And the point is, sorry? Yeah, so it was in the 70s, right? Yeah, but the point is that, well, after so much investment, right, today I can tell you that there's still no consensus, right, in the scientific community on what is a cancer stem cell, right? Bill just talked about CTCs. I can show you publications where they call CTCs cancer stem cells. And you go, by which logic? Doesn't have stem cell markers, right? But that is the kind of misunderstanding about this disease, right? So when we claim that we understand how it's originating, and that's the we've actually just slipped onto it, right? But now that we have, we are already talking with biotech companies about what can you do, and we're speaking with companies that can actually slow down the progression of cancer or even retard it at that stage. And it's a much milder version of the kind of chemo that you will get, right? But the reason we have to do this is because technically it's not qualified as a disease yet, right? But that's where the science will progress, right? If you can actually detect it that early, right? We just believe that in 10 years from now, people are gonna say, well, there was this terrible disease till these bunch of scientists came along and solved it.
Thank you. Here's a question from Dr. Howard.
Yes, hello, Ashish. Doctor, great to hear your work. Really great stuff you're doing. Really appreciate it. My question is this. My company specializes in regenerative medicine, regenerative tissue therapy. Okay, yep. Stem cells, right? And there's primarily, you know, mesenchymal or mesenchymal stem cells, primarily yep. derived from umbilical cord matrix, also known as Wharton's jelly, yep. and other afterbirth materials. And there's a lot of research saying that cancer patients are a no-no, absolutely not. Now, other research is saying that we are beginning to be able to use them, this type of therapy, against cancer. Where does that research really stand? Do you know?
Look, there is, from what I can tell, you know, there's a lot of regulatory issues around stem cells, right? In all honesty, we know the political reasons why that is the case, right? But that said, the reason we have actually, you would have understood from the presentation itself, we believe that the reason for this disease is it's actually because of stem cells, right? That's actually the originating point, right? And the reason we believe it is otherwise our results would not be correlating, and we've got thousands of samples now, right, where we can literally show you the difference, right, of what cancer stem cells are looking like, or stem cells of a cancer patient are looking like, right, versus a non-cancer patient, right? But that said, you're progressing towards what is going to be the potential cure. We have some thoughts on this because we understand stem cells very, very well, right? But that said, there are regulatory hurdles. I mean, we've just seen, not to put too fine a point on it, but we've actually had ethics committees of major hospitals tell us that can we drop the word stem cells, right? And to be very honest with you, you know, it's so funny because, look, it would have been a legit strategy, right, of the company to not disclose the science, right? Not disclose that it's coming from these stem cells, right? Because why would it have been legit? Because the reality is that we get such high accuracy. Well, all we needed to do is blinded samples, right? and we would actually show it, right, on a lot of samples. Case in point, if I can just move away slightly, I don't know if you guys know, but this was a story in, I read it in a book, during the war, right, the Second World War, right, there were a lot of Japanese that were put into concentration camps here as well, right, because it was war. Now, when they came back, of course, there were certain issues for them mingling into the society. But there was, and a lot of people were not getting jobs, right? But there was one job, right, that the Japanese in the primary industry just got, right? It was about identifying a chicken, male or female, a day-old chicken. And they had some, they would see it and go, male, female, male, female. Now, that can actually mean a considerable saving, right, for a farming community if you don't have to feed, right, all the chickens for a couple of days to know which one is the hen and which one is the thing, right? So that was, now the reason I'm telling you this, right, is that when people have so many biases, we could very easily have taken the stance that we won't tell you which one, we'll just do blinded trials and you can see that we're getting everything right. Right, because it's not like we're getting, I explained why. So by the way, one more thing. You know, when we actually first came out with a paper saying that we've got everything right, understand as scientists, no one expects to go into a clinical study and get everything right. Okay, it does not happen, right? But the point is, understand why it is happening. Because on our platform, you remember that Gumpertzian chart that I showed you, think about zero as the color blue, and a billion as the color red, right? Now, the reason we're getting it so right is because there are many colors in the middle, right? So the only way I get it wrong is if I'm colorblind or I'm really, really clumsy because you're talking about two ends of the spectrum, right? So I would have been very legit in not actually disclosing the cells because think about it as a strategy. If you don't know North America exists, well, then it's a much harder thing to find, right? It takes Christopher Columbus to, just fluke it, right? But the point is, if you know that there is a big land out there and you go, okay, it's far away, so let's provision for it, you'll still find it. But if you don't know there is something out there, it's much harder. So it was a legit strategy on our point, and we actually spoke to a lot of lawyers to find out how much should we disclose and how much should we not, right? But we finally decided that we're going to disclose because you get protection in mature markets like US, Europe, and Japan. And there is, the truth is, there will be copycat products in countries like China and India, but you know what? Those aren't the markets that are key, right? These are the markets that are key, right? So that is the reason why we've gone with the strategy of actually disclosing it. But when we went to the ethics committee, they tell you, drop the word, stem cells. So there are inbuilt biases in the system, and, sometimes that affects innovation, right? Because you have to go through these hoops. But
it's not the stem cells. Hold on, Ronald. We're going to come back to you. We have to go over here. Sorry. Peter?
Yeah.
Is your company private or public?
We're private.
You're public? It's trading stock?
No.
What?
We have, no, we're private. And to be very candid with you, we have very interesting investors. And the reality is that there are literally sovereign funds that are in talks with us right now because all they want is just show us the results in the West. And that's why our main focus is the clinical studies, right? Because the logic of these private equity funds is that, listen, there are 100 million people, insured patients in the US alone. All of them do a blood test once a year. If you detect even one or two cancers, it's a big breakthrough. If you detect every cancer, well, it's immense because it's a test that all of us must do, right? So the answer to your question is that we are actually talking to sovereign funds, and we have quite large private investors that have actually put money into us. But we're just focused on one thing. We want to finish our clinical trials, publish our data, and then go.
I have a question back here.
What is the second thing you're going to go after?
What's the second disease to go after?
So we haven't disclosed it, but...
we don't have to talk about it tonight. Let's go to Nurse Pat.
I'll tell you privately.
If insurance companies are willing to pay $600 each year to do the Cologuard test, it should be a no-brainer for them to jump ship. Number two, may I kindly suggest if you wanted to do a U.S. pilot study, you may want to consider Palestine, Ohio, where they just had that oil spill, and it's projected that 65% of the population there will develop cancer.
Oh, my God. Fair enough. Thank you.
Okay. We have lots of questions. We have some questions coming in on Zoom. We had trouble
with
the...
But I do know about the insurance thing. Interestingly, there are insurance companies talking to us as well.
Let's go back here to Wayne.
I just have a simple question. Isn't it true that a healthy individual who dies from old age is actually, if you really stutter it, you know my question already.
Yep.
So...
So interestingly, by the way, there's a paper of ours, there's a publication that we recently did on these particular stem cells play a massive role in three areas. If you want to understand cancer, if you want to understand tissue regeneration, if you want to understand aging, right? You need to understand the nature of these cells. So we have actually put a scientific paper on, there were a couple of Harvard professors that had asked us, because they heard us, and they just said that, listen, is there any possibility that you can give us the papers before it's published, right? Which we, of course, under NDA, we did. But answer to your question is that, my father used to say that if we live long enough and we don't die of something else, we'll die of cancer, right? Because, what is the number one cause of cancer? Sorry? It's actually aging. Right? It's aging. Why? Because the reality is, like I said, if you live long enough, you will get cancer. Because there is a specific, and because we understand the disease, there's a specific mutation that has to happen at some point. Right? So it's a question of what takes you first. Right? But that said, if we are able to detect it this early, right, there will be solutions that are going to come up that can undo it. Right? And... but aging is a big reason.
Ashish, there's some confusion within the Zoom people, people online. Can you confirm if you have a patent and if it's US-based, India-based, or UK-based patents?
US-based.
US, okay.
And we have multiple patents in progress right now.
Yes. Let's go over here to Leo.
Hi. That's awesome. I mean, the question... We need warp speed on your technology of a stage zero stem cell cancer diagnosis in order to bypass the regulatory hurdles. The lives that you will be saving are potentially in the billions. How long before your universal cancer diagnosis is the standard in every blood lab, do you think?
Yeah. So in answer to your question, by the way, don't get me wrong, it's not like the UK is saying that this is not useful. What they're saying is, push that aim out, push that claim out, right, by a couple of years. We file the patents, etc., that's a different thing. But the reason is, what they're saying is that you need to do a longitudinal study. And remember, you have to do it cancer by cancer, right? So it's going to take some time for us to claim that. But for us to claim that your cancer is present, well, it's easy, because if I say that this person has cancer, well, if he does a PET scan and says, yeah, he's got cancer, I've proven, right? The problem is not in our detection. The problem is... in ratifying steps that can be taken to prove whether we are right or wrong, right? Because what is defined as cancer is a tumor formation, which means that we have to wait and then think about it. There's an ethical reason. So you basically found out that someone actually has cancer, but you don't tell them because you keep it blinded, right? There's an ethical dilemma. So I don't know how better minds than me in my team are actually talking to regulatory bodies, unfortunately. But that's how research works, because you have to keep a double-blinded, because otherwise you've got an ethical dilemma here, right?
Less than 10 years?
Oh, yeah. By the way, I mean, we did have a meeting with the Cancer Moonshot guys, and we were just looking at their claims, and we were saying, listen, you guys, your claims are like, hey, in 100 years, we'll do great things. Who cares? We'll be dead. Not all of us, but...
Ashish, we have a question coming in from the internet. Gennady is asking, if the HRC test detects imminent cancer risk, what would be the protocol for preventing the emergence of cancer and or getting rid of the cells that are likely to cause cancer in the near future?
Good question. The issue is that we actually have conversations because, look, it can, incidentally, we know of solutions, potential solutions ourselves, right? But you got to understand, you can't be on both sides, right? You can't be coming up with a test and also coming up with a, you know, with a solution. But the point is that we are working with biotech companies, right, that are working on this with us under an NDA because we need to tell them how it's originating, right? But that said, you know, think about how this progresses. It's going to take us time to get ethics approval here that this is stage zero. At that time, right, the other company will be able to show that, but we're working on it with certain biotech companies. So hopefully, when we can make that claim, we will also have potential solutions.
Okay, we have a question here from George.
Yeah, there's a lot of harvesting of stem cells now and then reinjecting it into a person or another person for therapeutic reasons.
Yep.
So what if you get stem cells that are stage one cancerous stem cells, which you're saying that that's precursor to cancer, so you might be reinjecting cancer into somebody through stem cells from stage one?
No. So answer to your question, the reality is, as I understand it, the stem cell-based solutions, and this is exactly some of the ethical questions that get asked, right? But the point is that if you are giving your own stem cells, right, because what they're doing is they're taking your own stem cells, culturing it, injecting it back, right? So that is what you are doing, right? There is a question mark, or there's an ethical issue about taking someone else's stem cells. But because we understand the nature of the stem cells, right, it technically is not a problem, right? But that said, there's more research that needs to be done because we understand those stem cells that are a risk, right? And the point is that, the stem cells that are actually being injected are different. So there are caveats on this particular thing, but I can't tell you all the details because some of this is actually confidential.
I have a question coming from Zoom from Gary.
Yeah.
I had the Galley cancer screening last year. How does the Tzar Labs test compare with the Galley test?
Look, there's been no competitive test done, but the point is the results that I just showed you were of Galley, right? That was Galley was, what matters in science is what your results are of the clinical study. Well, it was 16.1% at stage one, so. The same argument holds if you're doing a test. It's not like a gamble, right? I might get it right, I might get it wrong. It's about you need to be at, if you speak to oncologists, you need to be at least in the 90%, right? But when it becomes translational. So I have spoken to NHS doctors, Harvard professors, et cetera, which said that, listen, the results don't show this as being translational. I won't say more. It's
Gary's wondering if the test is available anywhere in the world or
yes.
Okay. If someone in the US wants to get the test.
Unfortunately, like I said, I was transparent. The problem is we need fresh blood and understand the implications. Even if we can actually transport the blood, the problem is also at the other end because customs has to allow, otherwise they hold the blood.
Yes.
And then we have a problem. But there is a lab where this
understand.
Is.
Here's
is
a question
lodged.
Back here.
I'm wondering how exosomes fit into this equation.
There are many things in the blood, right? And the fact of the matter is that there are interrelationships between a lot of these cells, right? But that said, right, as I said, because we know how this particular, I told you why we feel we've got to the crux of the problem, because this is the original change that happens, right? And we know why, right? But again, we've given what we were willing to give in that paper, but there are certain things that we still, because the reality is that there's a lot more research that we are doing, because the implications are really quite massive. Yeah.
There's a question from Joel.
Yeah.
It's known that for many years we get better and better results in detecting and treating cancers. Is it known what percent of that improvement comes from earlier detection and what percent comes from more effective treatments?
Oh, look, I can tell you, prima facie, every cancer, right, the results you will get at an early stage is going to be head and shoulders above what you'll get at a later stage, right? Because, as I told you, the reality is, see, understand that, you know, what you got to understand about this disease is that when you hit it with medication, it mutates, right? So by the time you're hitting it, if it's actually already a, it's a, you know, it's a big thing, right? Then it's going to come back stronger. You see, the point that I was actually giving to your answer earlier, right, is that, you see, look at it from the doctor's perspective today, right? Once he does the, you know, once he does a biopsy, right, he does the mutational readings and goes, oh, I think this is the right medicine. So this is not, this is now personalized medicine, right? He hits you with that medicine, and then what he has to do is go conservative again, because he'd say, now we're going to wait for 3 months, right? Because we need to do another PET scan, and a PET scan is equivalent to 70,000 x-rays, so we can't do it often enough. At the end of the 3 months, right, they will actually do the scan. And what are they looking for? Is the tumor staying stable, and is the activity levels not changed from the previous PET scan? And if that's the case, they go, this is good news. The medicine is working, right? Let's not break something that isn't broken. It's broken, there's a tumor there, right? The fact of the matter is, why is the tumor not growing? Because the tumor is mutating to fight back. And then after, you know, so what does the doctor have to tell you? He'll say that we'll wait, but at some point this medicine will stop working, but don't worry, there'll be another medicine then. Well, you know, when it comes back, it's gonna be stronger. I'm not trying to actually find a fault in the doctor, because look, they have a tough job, right? Because they can't keep doing a biopsy, well, that's gonna spread more, right? So, but effectively, that's my big problem with this. We are trying to elongate your life. We're not trying to cure the disease at all, right?
We have time for two more questions. One back here, Kathy.
Thank you. Thank you. There's a rather large industry in the United States for treatment of cancer. I wonder if you've run across any overt resistance to your testing.
Oh, I'll be honest with you. Look, we've not had that many dealings as yet, right? Because we didn't make the breakthrough. But and I don't even, you know, I know some people can have issues with established systems, etc. The way I look at it is that, you know, their principle is do no evil. So they are always taking the conservative view to begin with, right? Even now, the way I see it is that. The reality is that, okay, I've disclosed my science, but it's legit for the system or the regulatory bodies to do a study right here. And then base their, you know, frankly, if you get the same results, they will accelerate your process, your progress into this country. Because let's face it, I mean, if you just look at the data of how much cancer is costing the American system today, it's not funny. Right, it's wasting a lot of funds. But like I said, it causes a lot of pain to the person, the family, the system. Right, so everyone has to find a solution, and we just think that we've actually made a significant progress. But we'll follow the steps. I mean, we've got to do the clinical trials here before we can launch it here. But we're trying.
So we have the last question back here. Yeah.
Actually, it's not really a question; it's a statement because. Human beings technically are generally cynical. And here you are, you're doing scientific research. Everybody wants the answers now to the questions of the future that will be developed. Okay. Obviously and logically, if you're rational and thinking, anything you catch earlier, whether it's construction or something, there's a problem,
yep.
Your chances of repairing it without having to tear everything else apart
exactly.
To get to it exactly. Is superior. And in time, it will progress to the results that you want, stopping
exactly.
It.
Exactly. Exactly.
Ladies and gentlemen, Ashish Tripathi.
Thank you so much. Good.
Amazing. Incredible. Awesome stuff. Now let's bring up our next speaker, who is the founder of this church and a leader in the age reversal movement around the world. Let's bring up Bill Faloon.
Okay. Well, that was a tremendous presentation, because I want to clarify a lot of the questions you had, because there are answers, and I retitled my update to age reversal and cancer. They have a lot to do with each other. Now, that media coverage about the 32% reduction in cancer death rates since 1991, publicized all over the place, I'm not impressed with it. And we were talking a little bit about cell phones or computers. Let's think about a 1991 cell phone that only improved 32%. Would we be impressed? I don't think so. We might keep with the old one, frankly, if it's only 32% improvement. But the reasons for those improvements, that was a question asked, mainly is a reduction in cigarette smoking. Well, which is good, but we're not smokers for the most part. We'd like to think there's some better ways. Well, yes, early stage diagnosis is a reason. Combinations of different chemotherapies are working, albeit at horrific side effect costs, and just more and more consolidation. Combination treatments, which we've advocated for decades, they're finally incorporating those into conventional oncology. But over 600,000 Americans are going to perish from cancer this year. So the fact that 32% fewer are dying doesn't take away from this huge number of cancer victims every year who are suffering and perishing. More patient-friendly curative treatments are needed. And good news is many of them are available right now in the form of repurposed medications. So questions we're asking, what if you have this test and it indicates a very early stage malignancy? Well, prostate cancer is very interesting. It's one of the few cancers that we can document. You make some changes in your diet, incorporate some repurposed medications, you can reverse early stage prostate cancer. So you get this test, indicates some disease being there. You go on a program for 3 to 6 months, including metformin, and cut out your red meat, your dairy, your processed foods, incorporate the vegetables and the fruits, all the anti-cancer foods and drinks that you know about. You may very well reverse that prostate cancer malignancy or a breast cancer malignancy, because breast and prostate cancers are very similar. A lot of people don't know breast cancers secrete a little bit of PSA. Prostate-specific antigen comes from breast tumors as it does prostate tumors. So you look at this study of people on metformin who are treated for prostate cancer, 40% reduced risk of a recurrence, a 25% increased survival rate with this one drug, metformin, which we talked a lot about at this church. So if that test that you just heard about indicates that you have a malignancy anywhere, you may want to get on metformin. And that alone may put that cancer into reverse. So next time you take the test, you don't have an indicator of that anymore.
If you have colon cancer and you are on metformin, you do a lot better. Your survival, your long-term benefits of metformin are quite apparent with colon cancer, quite common. And this is a drug that's not being prescribed by oncologists, which to me is just an absolute crime, because the data is there to show these huge benefits. The green are metformin-treated patients, the red are the ones not getting metformin. And so again, if you take this test and you have early-stage colon cancer, you want to get on metformin. And again, change your diet, change your lifestyle, exercise, do everything we know to reduce cancer risk and potentially put it in reverse. If you're concerned about contracting cancer and having a problem with it potentially developing that's incurable, wow, diabetics taking metformin, 62% reduced risk of getting pancreatic cancer. So again, if you have an early marker of pancreatic cancer, well, you probably want to try to get that malignancy removed if you can, or you may want to try metformin to see if you can make it go away. As it relates to the medical establishment ignoring published evidence, 2006, they did a study using an immune-boosting drug called interleukin-2, had been around since the 1970s, and they took a group of pancreatic cancer patients prior to therapy, being surgery in this case, and they gave them interleukin-2. Other control group did not get interleukin-2. So after 2 years, you had 33% of the people getting the interleukin-2 prior to surgery alive, a smaller percent in the non-pancreatic cancer or the non IL-2 group getting it. And 3-year survival, really remarkable, 22% surviving with interleukin-2 therapy before surgery, none. All dead in the group that was not given the IL-2, and a dramatic reduction in post-operative complications. People just given this drug. And what's scary, that's a 2006 study. I haven't seen any human data to replicate these incredible results. And we know 48,000 people a year dying of pancreatic cancer. Here's a potential way to save a lot of them, and it's not being incorporated into routine clinical practice. But you know about it, and if you were to get pancreatic cancer and undergo surgery, you know, think about it. Interleukin-2, a couple days before surgery, improves your odds of survival. Now, I've talked about a drug a lot at this church called cimetidine, and this is yet another intervention to consider if you have a test indicating you have an early stage malignancy. You might want to go on cimetidine. It can boost your NK function. It disables the tumor cell's ability to turn down immune function, and tumor cells are smart enough to do that. They will send signals throughout the body to suppress immune function. Cimetidine blocks that. Cimetidine also blocks cancer cell adhesion. So what happens is, if a patient is undergoing surgery and they take cimetidine before surgery and continue it thereafter, they survive a lot longer. The cimetidine group in this 1994 study had a 93% survival rate. And if you were not taking cimetidine, well, it was a lot less. So if you're going to undergo any kind of cancer therapy, consider 800 milligrams a day of cimetidine prior to surgery, and consider doing it after surgery. And the data is consistent. This is a 2002 study. If you're taking cimetidine, 84% survival over a long period. If you're not taking it, only 49%. So we've got this kind of data out there in the published literature. This could be used as an adjuvant cancer treatment. This could be used if you have an early indicator that a malignancy is occurring in your body. Get on cimetidine for 6 to 12 months and see what kind of happens. Really easy to do, and bear in mind, this is an over-the-counter drug. It doesn't cost a lot of money. You can buy it in any drugstore. And you take this 7 days prior to surgery, 800 milligrams, and continue that for about a year, and you get a whole lot of benefits. So you have all of this peer-reviewed data substantiating the adjuvant benefits of cimetidine as an anti-cancer therapy. We're here in 2023. I have yet to see an oncologist recommend that their patient get on cimetidine on their own. It doesn't even need a prescription. It's an OTC medication. So we're losing a lot of people when we don't have to. Over 50,000 Americans dying of colon cancer alone, and they're not being told to take cimetidine, which could perhaps cut that 50,000 maybe down to 30,000. That's a lot of human lives saved with one inexpensive drug that's being overlooked. And the data, by the way, on cimetidine, it continues. 2014 study showing you repurpose cimetidine in oncology, more cancer patients survive. And 2018, again, more and more data substantiating what we knew back in 1985. That's how long we've been recommending cimetidine for people who have cancer as an adjuvant approach. Doesn't cure it by itself. It simply adds on to the therapies you're using to improve your survival rates. SGLT2 inhibitors, this is an anti-diabetic medication that has a multitude of anti-aging properties. You lower glucose, you lower insulin, and what happens is, well, you get to live longer. These drugs are available over by prescription. They do cost a lot of money. If you have insurance, it'll usually cover it. And what these drugs do is they enable your kidneys to take the glucose and sodium in excess in your body so you can urinate it out. It takes a percent and reduces the amount of glucose, reduces the amount of insulin, and it can have a dramatic anti-aging effect. But we're talking about cancer tonight. And what they found is people taking SGLT2 inhibitor drugs had a 65% reduction in their risk of cancer. Wow. A 65% reduction, I would take pretty much anything to make that happen, which is why I've been taking this drug, by the way, for the last year. And no side effects, and my glucose and insulin levels and A1C, they've all optimized in response to this class of medication. Been around since 2013. There's still a lot of doctors that don't know how to prescribe it. So you've got to look this up on your own to reduce your risk of getting cancer. But as it relates to what you just heard, if you have that test done and it indicates you have an early stage malignancy, well, get on the SGLT2 inhibitor, get on the cimetidine, get on the metformin, change your diet, start to exercise more, All of that is going to enable you to potentially reverse some of these early stage malignancies or not let them progress as fast. And cancer patients, wow, you lower glucose and insulin the way these drugs work, and you're going to get some significant benefits. So if you have cancer right now, suggest, just like I do with cimetidine, metformin, and others, SGLT2 inhibitor drugs may save your life. And it may extend your life through its anti-aging mechanism of reducing the glycemic burden. What we're currently targeting right now is optimal. Not everyone can achieve this, but if you can use metformin, SGLT2 inhibitors, watch your diet, get involved in some exercise, try to target your glucose between 80 and 86 milligrams per deciliter. That's an optimal range. Hemoglobin A1C, try to get that between 5.4%, and fasting insulin, try if you can. It's not easy. Get it below 5 to 7. And it was the SGLT2 inhibitors that for the first time in my life got my fasting insulin below 5. It had been 8 or 9, despite me taking metformin, doing intermittent fasting, watching what I eat. I could never push fasting insulin down to the optimal range. The SGLT2 inhibitor drug enabled me to do that. It's been as low as 3, and I'm just shocked, considering I've tried my entire life to push it down, and only that class of drug made it happen. So you get cancer, and you're told we can put you on palliative therapy, keep you alive for a couple years, you're going to be miserable, or we can check you into hospice, and you usually die in 5 to 10 days. A lot of people choose hospice, and I understand the grueling palliative therapy, lots of chemo, radiation, it's grueling. But if you go on palliative therapy and you stay alive, CRISPR may eventually evolve in your lifetime, be it a limited 1 or 2 year lifetime, to save your life. And this came out last year, at the end of last year. They used some CRISPR therapy to boost immune function in solid tumor patients, and they were able to see some degrees of efficacy. So this is a therapy that we feel will eventually enable us to reverse aging. It's also being used as a potential cancer treatment to boost immune function. And with aging, we suffer immune senescence. We all need more effective immunity. And this therapy, CRISPR, which is going to eventually control aging, may be effective against cancer. The preliminary study indicated that. As it relates to aging, well, news came out. They were able to extend maximum lifespan in a rat for the first time. They were able to take something that they could never live, let it grow old enough beyond a certain period of time, and they pushed that ahead about 1 month. I guess it's equivalent to the 123-year-old woman who is purportedly the longest living person ever lived, give her an extra couple years. It's a major milestone, by the way, in research. We can extend average lifespan. We can extend median lifespan. We can extend healthy lifespan, but we've never been able to get up over that 123 years in a person yet. They did it in a rat. We can translate that, we hope, into humans. They were using young plasma to do that, a young plasma fraction that we think they're going to look to make that available to people at some point so we can extend our maximum lifespan. And then we look at the billionaires who are missing this boat, and it's not always their fault, but what I want to point out is this individual, he did pretty much what he should do to stay healthy, and he lived a decent life as far as his age. I mean, he ate healthy, he aggressively exercised, he paid attention to his health, and then he had a fall, fractured, and died. A real common problem. I advocate for everybody, just think about what you're doing. I've seen over the years, observed healthy people in their 80s, 90s, everything's going right for them until they take that fall. Bone fracture. And there are ways to accelerate the healing of bone fractures, by the way. A drug out there called Forteo, it's a brand name. It can actually double the speed rate of a fracture, and only a couple doctors seem to know about that. So if anyone does suffer a fracture, consider that drug to double that speed limit. And again, these people with enormous amounts of money, and my critique is, did they put money into aging research, serious money in? Because when you get $20 billion, you'd like to maybe live a little bit longer. If you think 91 is a long time, it sure isn't for me. I would never accept that as an upper limit for what I'm trying to accomplish. But I'm going to go back to 2015. This is a slide I showed at the church. This individual, Fred DeLuca, founded Subway, and at the time of his death, it was worth about $3.5 billion. He had leukemia, by the way. He went to Yale for a STEM stem cell transplant. And what happens, unfortunately, when you get someone else's stem cells, graft versus host disease can manifest. And that's pretty much what killed him. And it's unfortunate at the age of 67. I'm 68, by the way. I'd hate to have encountered leukemia at 64, 65, went through the grueling chemo, stem cell transplant, and then a horribly painful death in which your own immune system attacks you. That's graft versus host. Someone else's bone marrow stem cells put into you, and then those stem cells recognize you as an enemy, and they relentlessly attack you. So had he been alive, though, today, he was a majority owner, his value of his Subway franchise would have been about $10 billion. And I give this example when I talk to high-end people who are very concerned about making more money. And I said, the easiest way for you to make more money is to live longer. You'll have more of it. It's not that complicated to do the calculations. And recently, the co-founder, minority interest owner, he made it to age 90. He's worth over $1 billion, and he too died. And he gave $200 million to a charity that supports family issues, and I don't even know what that is. I didn't bother to look it up before I did my presentation. But I would wish these people, instead of putting that kind of money into something that I frankly don't know about, I'd like to see more going into aging research, because your priority at age 90 should be, what can I do to reverse that process? Because it's eventually going to kill me. Now, in April, I'll be speaking at a very high-level scientific conference in the Bahamas. They're holding it at the Atlantis Hotel. There's going to be just a huge number of scientists talking. These people all have MDs, PhDs after their name. I'm about the only one that does not. But these are the upper echelon people involved in aging research. This is not for lay people. This is a very complex scientific conference. There'll be a lot of interactions with a lot of scientists. The goal, find a cure for aging in our lifetime. And this is being put on by some very incredible people. I can't compliment them enough for doing it, but that is going to occur in April, which is why we won't have a service here in April. I'll be in the Bahamas, not just working on this project, but also working on the perpetual project. I'm going backwards here at the bottom. I'm going to talk more about the perpetual project in March, but this is for people who want to join me on a voyage in an attempt to live forever, where we're going to engage in lots and lots of experimental therapies, lots and lots of diagnostic testing. We're going to see what works amongst our membership group. It may be a couple hundred, maybe a couple thousand of us. We've got a computer database we've identified in which we can track every single participant, see how well they're doing. If someone is doing really well, let's see what their blood workup looks like. Let's see what all their other diagnostics looks like. Let's see what interventions they personally chose for themselves. I may be in a position to launch this in the Bahamas. Doesn't mean you can't take advantage of it here, by the way. You can take advantage of it anywhere in the world as long as you have internet and are able to log in to your personal program. So that is my presentation to follow up on what you got to hear today. And I really wanted to emphasize that early stage malignancies, I believe, can be reversed with aggressive dietary changes, a lot of exercise, repurposed medications, metformin, interleukin-2, cimetidine, valproic acid, melatonin. There is a host of off-label medications that have anti-cancer effects, including low-dose aspirin. So we've talked about that in many, many services at this institution. We'll continue to talk about it because at some point, many of you are going to have to deal with a malignancy or people you love, and you'd like to know that there's more that can be done than what conventional oncology offers. So thank you all for showing up, and I'll be happy to answer any questions. Yeah, there's a bunch of pharmacies. If you go on the internet, you type in metformin offshore pharmacy, you'll find lots of them selling it. And it's an inexpensive drug in the U.S. It's also relatively inexpensive offshore. So a lot of people are going offshore, including me. I don't want to pay U.S. prices for medications like the SGLT2 inhibitor. Walgreens wanted $600 for a one-month supply. And my insurance said, we're not going to cover it because you're not diabetic. And I found it for $35 offshore. So I advocate not just to save the money and make it affordable, but it's a way of protesting the corrupt system that exists in this country, where a drug that costs virtually nothing to make is priced beyond what the average person can afford.
Question from Dr. Howard.
Hi, Bill. Great information, as always. Thank you so much. My question is, the slide talking about the SGLT2 2 inhibitors. I think that's what I got it right, maybe not.
You did.
Okay. Specifically mentioned the, what it was, a 65% reduction in cancer risk in hyperglycemic individuals.
Correct.
What about non-hyperglycemic
individuals? Oh, they don't have that data yet. The SGLT2 inhibitors, the drug companies spent hundreds of millions of dollars doing tests on diabetics, proved it worked, got it approved to treat type 2 diabetes. But high glucose levels occurs in non-diabetics. Most of us, if we're over age 40, 50, we are pre-diabetic. We've got higher than optimal glucose and insulin and A1C. And I don't think that applies, by the way, to a lot of people in this room, but you look at the typical American out there with an obesity epidemic right now that's approaching 40% in this country. They need that drug, whether they're formally diagnosed with diabetes or not, they need that drug right now to reduce their cancer risk, along with a host of other disorders.
We have a question from the internet, and it's a question about supplements. Are there any supplements that you could recommend for a person with ALS to help them?
I think there are some of those out there, and I don't have a list of them right now, but I think we posted that on a website. There's like several different combinations that people were using, and I really can't get into that right now because there's a couple different choices, and I don't have that information.
Thank you. And anyone who wants that answer, just email me, and I'll get that information to them.
Yeah, we'll email them a whole publication on that.
Thank you, Bill.
Great idea. Yeah.
Question from George.
Yeah, what would you recommend? You mentioned a lot of these different things as precancerous prevention type things, but for just the average person, what would you recommend that they would take to stave off potentially cancer? Like, which one of these things?
Well, we recommend turning down mTOR, the mechanistic target of rapamycin. Cancer cells use that to rev up cancer cell propagation. And intermittent fasting can do that. Certainly metformin does that, rapamycin. There's a lot of nutrients that people will use, but it's so important to emphasize what you put in your body. If you're going to eat overcooked meat or red meat at all, processed meat, dairy, if you're going to eat foods that increase your cancer risk and avoid your cruciferous vegetables, avoid the healthy foods, the legumes. I've talked about an optimal diet here before. You're going to be at a much higher risk for cancer, and that's really well documented. So there's so much that people can do today to reduce their cancer risk. Losing weight, frankly, is a major way of making that happen, and in the process of losing weight, you'll often start eating healthier in order to enable that weight loss to occur. So that's just some of my basic suggestions.
Last call for questions. Bill Faloon.
Thank you.
All right, we have one more treat for you, and that's another video from Charlie. But before we go there, I want to mention that in April, we will have a Zoom service, but we will not be here in person in April. Next month, we will have another in-person service, and that will be March 23rd at the regular time. Also, keep in mind, this event, these presentations have all been recorded. You can watch them again. You can listen to them again. I believe we'll have the slide deck available also through our website. So go there and tell your friends all about the recordings. But now, let's bring up Charlie Kam to give a quick introduction on his next video. Okay.
These guys are great. You know, Bill Faloon inspires the heck out of me. And, well, Ashish, I love him. He always does. But I want to say one thing. Now, Ashish is not from the United States, and so when we finally met and we work together, you know, I'm from Chicago. I'm born and raised in the United States, so I had the, I know, right? I love it. But I was as frustrated as everybody here that we don't have that test in the United States. So as soon as I got in touch with, you know, we got together, I said, okay, let's see what we can do. And I immediately contacted my senator in the United States, which is Senator Durbin. He put me in touch with his healthcare policy director, Jessica McNeese. We had about an hour long Zoom meeting with her, and she thought it was amazing. So I said to her, look, we got to get in touch with the Biden Cancer Moonshot people. So she helped me arrange to get that, and we got in touch with Dr. Catherine Young. Dr. Catherine Young and Dr. Danielle Carnival, those are the two that run the cancer, Biden's Cancer Moonshot program. And they loved it. They thought it's amazing. So we're like, okay, great. And they're going to get back to us. Well, the things are slow. It's just slow. Now, I'm not saying it's their fault, but, you know, bureaucracy. But what I can say is if you guys want to help, write letters to them. And, you know, it's not put letters in mailbox. And nowadays, we can do emails. There, those particular ones, like Catherine Young and Danielle Carnival, they have Twitter accounts, they have LinkedIn, they have Facebook. Just write to them and say, hey, we saw Tzar Labs presentation by Ashish. We want to see, you know, we want to see Tzar Labs technology in the United States. We want it for us. If they get that kind of letters and that kind of pressure, then they'll really pay attention and start pushing it forward. But it, you know, that's, I'm just saying, like, if you guys want to help, that's how you can help. That's what I do, and I contact as many politicians as I can because that's how it gets you get things to move a little faster in this country because it is right. I want it. I want it here.
Great idea.
Thank you. So, now, when I was up here earlier and I did that I presented that video, I told you, look, we're all lucky because we've got these technologies that are here that can help us, and some of the technologies are here and some are coming. But they're not all here. And I said everybody here is lucky. Now some people here and outside that are watching, they may not be around for some of these technologies. But they're still lucky that they're alive today because, you know, everything I talked about earlier, that's like what we consider plan A, where you can rejuvenate yourself and make yourself better and you can live longer. But there are some people that are right at the cusp of getting ready to die. Well, for them, there's cryonics. And that didn't exist before the 60s, but if you were born and you're alive from that time and now, you've got to start to consider cryonics because you'd be shocked at how many people are signed up for cryonics that are, you know, really prominent, but they want to keep it low profile. But it is true, and it because it's becoming more and more of a reality that it will happen. I mean, you, if you just think about the fact that technology is growing exponentially, the idea that we can't unfreeze something that we froze, I mean, that's not as hard as getting a rocket to land on Mars, really. It's not rocket science. So all I'm saying is that we can do it. So this next video is about cryonics, and it's really kind of an homage to an old film, a 1957 Ingmar Bergman film, which was called The Seventh Seal. And that film, if you haven't seen it, it's considered one of the top 10 foreign films. And it was about this knight who came back from the war, and he's walking down the beach, and he sees this figure coming at him, and he realizes it's death, you know, because death is that with the cloak, and he's got that Sith thing that he's keeping, but he also knew that death liked to play chess, so he challenges him to a game of chess to buy more time, because he says if I can beat chess, I'm kind of cheating death, and I want to live longer. Well, you can kind of figure out that death back then wasn't gonna lose, but what I did was I made a music video. Updates it with cryonics in mind. So go ahead, Doug, show this one. I hope you guys like it.
I asked my grandmother, where did grandfather go? And she replied, but things are different now. Science has changed it all. And getting old is age old fallacy. There's a new lease on life. So if tragedy strikes, things are at the worst they'll ever be. We can try one thing more when death is right at the door. We can preserve ourselves. Don't know if it works for sure yet, but it's a much smarter bet.
saw the news today.
Tragedy.
So many dying
or not.
Such disease.
Scientists are baffled as they continue to search for a cure. Sources.
They buried all their dead. While I thought in my head these tragedies don't have to be. Science has changed it all, and being buried is a travesty. Now we don't have to go, we'll just be put on hold and realize this new reality. We'll freeze them and then we'll store them until we find a cure for them. Then they can return to life.
Thank you, Charlie, for your inspiring and fun videos. Always great to have you here. And Bill and Ashish, thank you for your presentations. Wonderful. We have a dinner now in your honor. And please join us for a delicious dinner and healthy food. Looking forward to seeing you next month.